crazy, to say the least. You know, and yeah, you have to sometimes as a writer, I mean, it's not necessarily, you know, glamorous to, you know, as much as people think sometimes when you're researching a character like that. So, perfectly understand kind of your thinking behind that. I mean, it's not really that much fun, but then again, you know, it's something that if you want to engage with your reader.
Oh yeah. I think really it makes a very interesting read, you know, That's what it is. I think it makes for the people who like this genre, it makes for a very entertaining read because, I can remember when I was like maybe 9 years old or 10 years old, I wrote a little play, you know, and my mother looked at it and it was about these monsters that were, you know, killing people and stuff. And characters would get killed off and there would be like no reaction from the other characters to this death. And my mother looked at it, she goes, you know, she says, it's really good except nobody seems to care that people are getting killed. So I realized, you know, you've got to be able to grasp that emotional aspect of things when you're dealing with characters, because my books are very character driven. And, but I mean, you're right. There's a definite fun aspect to writing evil people, except that when you kind of get in their minds to what they're really thinking about stuff, that's what I'm saying. You know, it can be a little, like, I need to get away from it for, you know, a little while and I'll do something else, work on another story or something like that.
Yeah. And, you know, I mean, yeah, like I said, some, you know, I think in terms of the criminal genre, it seems to be becoming a lot more popular nowadays. We see a lot of documentaries. We see a lot of podcasts actually too that cover a lot of true life crime. And it seems like, you know, a lot of women have a tendency to kind of gravitate towards that as well.
Yes.
You know, what do you think right now? I mean, in terms of, you know, this genre right now being so popular.
I think it's almost like, it's sort of like, I think with scary movies, you know, if kids will go to a scary movie and it scares them and stuff, but they know it's not real. And I think people need that in their lives, you know, this thing of dealing with something evil because there is an awful lot of evil in the world, be able to read about it and know everything's going to be okay. You're right about the ladies out there. I mean, most of my readers are women. In fact, you mentioned Floating Twigs for younger people. It's actually, I wrote it for an all-age audience, and most of my readers are like 65 and over. Most of the people who read it are that age group. And apparently loved it because, you know, reader reviews are really fabulous. But I have a lot of fans who are ladies out there who are reading this stuff, and especially the detective books. Some of the ladies who read Floating Twigs did not like Hell is Empty at all because it's a very different book. My thing is, you know, how could you read the first three pages and not know this is not the same thing? But it's definitely a good thing, I think, that people are interested in reading about crime and detective novels and things like that. You know, there's a reason that people like David Baldacci and James Patterson and all make an awful lot of money because that's a very popular genre with everyone, I think.
With that being said, will you, you know, besides the crime novels that you're doing right now, you know, there, you know, are you thinking about, you know, doing other kind of genre novels? I know, you know, a lot of authors are starting to kind of branch out a little bit in terms of the readership. Are you thinking about maybe going back to a genre more like Floating Twigs or anything like that once this with the series is done?
Well, actually, the one I'm working on is a literary novel like Floating Twigs. It's it was a writer friend of mine was saying, you know, he said, all these people that are clamoring for another book like Floating Twigs, they're not joking. They want to read another book like that. So I'm working on another literary novel like that. And I've decided to write like one detective and one literary every year. So my new one should come out just before Christmas, which is, I think, a good thing. And it's called Canary's Song. That's with S apostrophe on the end, plural. And the next one I will write for the Tony Pantera series is called Whirligig of Time. And it's, I mean, I've already got it all planned and everything. I know the basics of the story already, where I'm going with that. Then after that, I'm going to write a sequel to Floating Twigs. I haven't titled it yet, but it's about the main character as an adult. You meet his brother. Well, you don't really meet his brother. His brother's gone off to join the army at the beginning of the book of Floating Twigs. And he goes in search of his brother because he never sees or hears from him again. There are reasons for that. But I've already got that one already planned. So next year's writing is already planned as well. So I'll be kind of going back and forth with those. And I also have a few horror novels in the back of my head too.
Well, we talked, you talk a lot about, you know, getting feedback, especially from your fans and all that as well. I mean, let's expand on that a little bit. I mean, you know, how great is it, first of all, and you know, how great is it that, first of all, you do get a lot of instant feedback, especially nowadays with the idea of social media and people, you know, reading the books. And you also said that you have beta readers that actually read the novel before finished work, as it were. How's it for you to get that kind of instant feedback? And does that affect you at all in terms of, you know, maybe what you're thinking out in the future? I mean, obviously with the Tony Pantera series, you know, there might be some criticisms about some of the earlier books that may go and travel to the for the sequential books, as it were. Tell me a little bit about that, getting this feedback.
I have 4 beta readers, and actually the one who is the most critical is my wife. So they will read my books before they go out. And their feedback, for me, it's invaluable because it gives me a sense of someone else who's reading the book and are they enjoying it or not? Is there something about the book that bothers them? These kinds of things. Because I know if one of my beta readers has a problem with something, then others will too. I'm very in tune to what they have to tell me. I'm very open to that criticism and feedback. The good feedback stuff is reader reviews, because between like Goodreads and Amazon, I have over 4,000 ratings and reviews on Floating Twigs, with the extreme majority being 5-star reviews. And you know, that kind of lets you know, you know, You did something good here, you know, that people are really liking. And a lot of people are writing these reviews are comparing Floating Twigs to Kill a Mockingbird, which is, to me at least, high praise indeed. So, you know, the positive feedback kind of helps me put my butt in the seat every day, you know. Because I know people are enjoying what I write. And the feedback from people who are finding fault, you know, it's very often just on the money in terms of what I need to change. I don't listen too much to reader criticisms in terms of my, you know, people who buy the book and read it or something. Because first of all, I don't know who they are. And I don't know what kinds of ideas and prejudices they bring to it. I mean, I had a guy the other day who wrote Floating Twigs needed illustrations. And I was thinking, no, it's just, it is not a book that needs illustrations at all. It's, you know, you get these things sometimes and you just, it's kind of like water off a duck's back in a sense, when you hear criticisms from somebody that, I mean, you don't know what kind of baggage they bring to their reading. And so it can be legitimate or not. But I write for myself and edit for my beta readers. And so far it's worked out pretty good.
You know, a lot of writers' dreams is to, you know, get their book or get their series of books made into movies. And, you know, it's always a kind of little fun to kind of figure out who you want to cast in certain roles as well, you know, in terms of your books or whatever. Is that something that comes across in your mind if you end up getting a movie deal in terms of your books?
I've had several people in reviews mention it would make a good movie, especially Floating Twigs. As far as casting goes, I'll be honest with you, I'm not really up on who's who in Hollywood right now in terms, because I mean, the protagonist in Floating Twigs is turning 13. So, you know, other than maybe one of the actors from Stranger Things or something, one of the boys in that, you know, I don't think in those terms. I guess if it were to come down to it, and say we're making a movie, and they found somebody that to me just wasn't the physical type, I'd wonder why. But I've been asked that question before in terms of, you know, who would you cast? And I was like, I really have no idea.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough with some of the younger actors as well. And it's one of those things where, you know, in Hollywood, I think it's a lot of, when it comes to the younger individuals, it just happens to be just one of those things we have to search for search for a person that's going to be, you know, the first, maybe the first time that they, you know, they've acted in a major role like that. So, yeah, I perfectly understand that if you don't have any idea for that. But, you know, it's always...
Well,
always
I will say my publicist is... talking about my book, Floating Twigs especially, and hoping that he can get some indie production company to do it. But, you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, we'll have to see. But like you said, I mean, it's, you know, one of those things. And I think people are kind of craving entertainment too. I figure once 2021 happens, hopefully production goes into overdrive. So they'll want as much content as they possibly can, just in case something happens like this again. So hopefully that ends up being the case. We've got quite a few of your novels out right now. Floating Twigs obviously is out right now. Two of the books in the Tony Pantera series is currently out right now as well on Amazon and anywhere that you want to get your books. So anything else you want to promote?
Well, there's my website, you know, we all have a website, and it's pretty easy, charlestabb.com. That's two B's in tab, T-A-B-B. And people can go there. They can sign up for my newsletter. They can check out the jacket blurbs of my books, including the new one that's coming up. As a matter of fact, just today, I posted the cover for that one on my website. And, you know, get to see some pictures of me and my family, find out a little bit about me, that kind of thing. And I also write some short essay articles just about various things, family, traveling, you know, wondering who people are out there who are reading my books, that kind of stuff. So I do have a blog section.
Yeah, who usually does your covers?
I have a company called eBook Launch. It's ebooklaunch.com. And I mean,